You know, many people don't realize that Christ Fellowship hasn't always been a big church. In fact, when people tell me that they've never been a part of a church this big, I usually look back at them and say, well, neither have I, because Christ Fellowship just keeps getting bigger and we're reaching more people today than we did last week or last month. But you know, we didn't start out to be a big church. Christ Fellowship actually started in my parents' living room back in the 1980s as a Bible study with just about 20 people gathered around. But soon we outgrew that living room and we moved here to Grove Park Elementary School in what they call a cafetorium, which I'm not even sure is a real word. Yeah, I know it doesn't really look like much, but back then, this was home to us. And it became a place where people found their spiritual home. They found a family they could belong to. You know, if you had asked us back then if we could ever have imagined becoming the church that we are today, and reaching thousands of people across South Florida and doing all the work that we're doing here in our communities and around the world, we probably would have laughed out loud. I mean, we didn't have a vision for that. We couldn't see it back then, back here. All we saw was this. Maybe you're there today in your own life. Maybe all you can see is where you are right now. You're kind of blinded by your current condition. You can't imagine it getting any better or any different. Listen, one of the lessons we learned right here was just be faithful where you are. If you're faithful where you are, God will get you where you need to be. And I believe that somebody needs to hear that today. If you're faithful where you are, God is faithful to get you where you need to be. You know, so many times we're in a season of life and we think, is this really all there is? I mean, is this really God's plan for my life? Because I think I probably could have come up with something a little bit better. But the truth is, there is something in this season that God wants to use to prepare you for your next season, a work that he wants to do in you before he can do his full work through you. And if you are faithful with your here, God will get you there. Just be faithful. In Luke chapter 16, around verse 10, Jesus said, if you're faithful in the little things, you're going to be faithful with more. But if you're unfaithful or dishonest in the little things, then you're going to be untrustworthy with more. So be faithful where God has you right now. So after 7 long years of being faithful right here in Grove Park School, we found an old horse barn out on North Lake Boulevard that was for sale. And we thought, hey, we could turn that barn into a church building. But the building was going to be way too big for just the 70 or 80 people that we had meeting here in the school. We started to get a vision that was bigger, a vision that was going to stretch us, a vision that would take us from where we are to where God actually wanted us to be. And that applies to your life. When you have a vision for your life that is bigger than you, it's going to stretch you. It's going to take you places you never dreamed of. If you remember at the beginning of this year, our church kicked off 2017 studying a scripture found in Isaiah chapter 54, verse 2 that says, stretch your tent curtains wide, do not hold back, lengthen your cords and strengthen your stakes. In that passage, it's like God is saying, I can't do everything I want to do in the space you have right now in your life, so you better make some room. You better get bigger for what I'm getting ready to do. But notice in that verse, it says, you have to enlarge. You stretch wide. God's not going to enlarge you. He's not going to stretch you. That's what you have to do. You have to make room. See, when we were here at Grove Park, we didn't wait until we grew before we stepped out in faith. We enlarged. We made room for God to show up. I wonder where you need to make room in your life, where you need to stretch a little bit, where you need to enlarge and make room for God, because as you do, I guarantee you, he's going to show up and do more than you ever thought or imagined. You know, this weekend is Vision Weekend at our church, and we're talking about the vision that God has for us together as his church here in South Florida. But it's more than just that. It's also about you and about your life and about the vision that God has for you. And as your pastor, I want you to flourish. I want to see your life get bigger. I want to see you go farther than you ever dreamed or imagined, because as you live out your God-given destiny, as you flourish, then we as the church together, man, we flourish and we live out the destiny together that God has for us. The church isn't a building you go into. It's not a club you belong to. And the church is every one of us, every day, everywhere we go. And as we individually are stretching and growing and enlarging our vision, stepping into everything God has for us, then together the church is vibrant and strong and growing into everything God has for us to be and to do. Yeah, I'm so glad that Christ Fellowship didn't stay here in Grove Park Elementary School for more reasons than one, trust me. But I'm glad we got a bigger vision. I'm glad we stretched and stepped out in faith and that we took a risk, or we would have missed you. And by the way, it was a risk, because I remember back in the day, the banks would not lend our church any money. We didn't have enough people. In fact, counting all the kids and counting pregnant women two times, we only had about 80 people. And so we all had to sacrifice together to buy that old horse barn. We had to give our time and our resources to step into the vision that God had for us. People sold extra vehicles they had and motorcycles. They didn't go on vacation for a year. We emptied out our bank accounts just so that we could buy that old horse barn and turn it into a spiritual home where thousands would find Jesus. And then just a few years later, we outgrew the horse barn. And I'm glad we didn't just stay there and think, wow, we've really grown big. We got more people than we ever thought. No, because if we had stopped then, just think of all the people that we would have missed. Think of all the people that would still be spiritually homeless today. See, that's why we as a church will always be a going church. We will be expanding and we'll be enlarging, because there are still thousands and thousands of people in our communities that don't know Christ. And God has sovereignly placed you and me right here together at this time in history to tell them, to show them, to help them find their way back home.
What's the longest time you've ever spent in the hospital? For me, that's what the first 3 months of my life was like. I was born with spina bifida, which means I basically can't walk. I don't have any feeling in my body from the waist down. And some of the most painful childhood memories include hospital visits and doctor's visits. But my family and I were determined to have a normal childhood for myself. I went to school and had friends, but it was still painful at times. Seeing everyone being able to go to the beach, go to the pool, play soccer, football, it was hard. As I got older, I tried to find a place where I can call home. Then came the church and the mall. Something about Christ Fellowship was different. We were so welcomed. I never felt like an outsider. I felt like I found the home I was looking for. We found ourselves coming back to Boynton campus every Sunday. My mom and I even took the journey class together. Right there, I prayed the prayer of salvation and found a relationship with Jesus. After that decision, I began to see God move in miraculous ways. On baptism Sunday, I watched Pastor Todd preach the importance of baptism and what that declaration of faith means for each one of us. He told a story about a man named Dwight, who was a paraplegic in a wheelchair just like me, who finally left his house because he decided it was his time to attend a campus to be baptized. Something came over me in that moment that I can't explain. It was this feeling like I couldn't leave church without being baptized. If Dwight could do it, why couldn't I? So outside of the Boynton campus in the parking lot, I was carried out of my wheelchair and lowered into the pool to be baptized and raised to life. The best part was, my baptism was just the starting point for me. From there, I found amazing friends in our young adults ministry. These people have come alongside me and have done everything they can to make me feel like I can fit in. I mean, they've gone as far as carrying me on the beach. Who do you know would do that? They've shown me there's nothing they won't do to make sure I'm a part of everything that they do. To me, home is a place where you can be yourself, where the people there are loving and welcome you with open arms. Home is a place where you feel safe and know there are people there that will carry you every step of the way, both literally and figuratively, to places you never imagined you can go, to do things you would never imagine you would do. Home is a place I found at Christ Fellowship Boynton Beach. It's the place where I can be myself, where I'm always welcomed, included, and comfortable. It's the place where I first learned about the incredible love of God. This is my home, and I'm so grateful for it. You have no idea.
I've seen that video a few times already, and every time I get choked up. I'm sorry. I love our church. I love that there's a place for everyone to find their place, to find out who God has for them to be and walk in that in a family, in a community. I want to welcome everybody joining us today at all of our different campus locations. It is truly great to be connected up to talk about Vision Weekend and this vision that God has for our church family together. And Julie and I have been praying about this weekend for months, literally. And as I was praying about it, I was praying, God, I want to get your vision for, I want God's vision, not Todd's vision. For your, it's your church, it ain't my church, right? So God, what is it that you want to say? What is it that you want to do in our church? And so I had to go back to the beginning of the church to get God's vision. I went back to the book of Acts where the church was just getting started. And let me just set the table for what a few verses we're gonna look at today. Jesus had been crucified, resurrected, and he spent some days, 40 days, walking around, talking to his followers. He revealed himself to hundreds of people. And right before he is ascending up into heaven, he tells his followers, listen, you gotta go, we call this the Great Commission, you gotta go into all the world and tell everybody about me and about God. And you gotta teach them the things that I taught you and baptize them in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And I'll be with you to the ends of the earth, right? And then he says, but don't go yet. Actually, first go to Jerusalem and wait for the Holy Spirit to come on you. Then you'll have the power to do everything that you're called to do. And so in Acts chapter 1, verse 8, these are the words of Jesus. He said, but you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and in Judea and in Samaria and to the ends of the earth. You will be my witnesses in Jerusalem. That's where you live. That's where you work. That's where you are known. You'll be my witnesses there. And in Judea, that's the region that you live in. You are entrusted with a region, church, to make a difference in those people's lives. In Samaria, Samaria was the place where they were misunderstood and not liked very much. Those were the enemy. And Jesus said, even there, that's where you're supposed to be my witnesses. And to the ends of the earth, you'll receive power to do this. So they go wait in the upper room for the Holy Spirit to come, which by the way, we need the Holy Spirit to do everything God is calling us to do. Individually and as a church, we need the Holy Spirit. We need his power. I mean, the Holy Spirit's power is what empowers us to fulfill the purpose that God has on our life. And in the coming weeks, we're gonna be talking about the Holy Spirit and his person and his power and his presence in your life. But for today, the Holy Spirit falls on the believers in the upper room and the men and women that were gathered there. They rush into the street of Jerusalem and they begin to preach the gospel of Jesus Christ. They begin to speak in unknown languages that they had never studied or learned. And all the Jews from all over the world that had gathered together in that place for the celebration of Pentecost, they heard the message of Jesus proclaimed in their own native tongue. And then Peter gets up and preaches the sermon of his life and tells him about this Jesus of Nazareth, whom they crucified as a savior of the world. And this is what it says in verse 37. Peter's words pierced their hearts. And they said to him, and to the other apostles, brothers, what should we do? What do we have to do to be saved? Peter replied, each of you must repent of your sins and turn to God and be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ. These people, on the day of Pentecost, so impacted by the pure gospel and power of the Holy Spirit that he says, what do we have to do? And I want you to note that word repent. That word repent actually means we turn from our old life and we walk in a new life. That's what that means. So following Jesus and experiencing everything that God has for me is more than just praying a prayer at the end of a sermon or even coming forward and getting a little white Bible. It is about repenting, which means I'm no longer going my own way, I'm going God's way. I used to think this was the way, but now I see that this way is only gonna lead me down a path of loneliness and destruction, so I'm gonna turn 180 degrees. I'm gonna do a 180 and I'm gonna follow after Jesus. And that's what we're calling all of us to, right? And it doesn't mean you're gonna always get it right and always get it perfect, but man, your heart's intent is to follow the way of Jesus. And maybe some of you here today, that's what you need to do, is you need to turn from your own way and walk in the way of God and his life, and you will experience the future and the purposes that God has just for you. Well, that day, 3,000 people get saved, which is a pretty good altar call. And then we see a picture of how the church actually lived out their faith. And that's what I'm gonna look at for just a minute. In Acts 2:42, it says they, the Christians, the Christ followers, they devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and to fellowship, to the breaking of bread and to prayer. Everyone was filled with awe at the many wonders and signs performed by the apostles. All the believers were together and had everything in common. They sold properties and possessions to give to anyone who had need. Every day they continued to meet together in the temple courts. They broke bread in their homes and they ate together with glad and sincere hearts, praising God and enjoying the favor of all the people. And say that last sentence with me out loud at all of our locations. And the Lord added to their number daily those who were being saved. See, there's increase. I see a couple things that pop out to me about these Christians, what they had in common. They had a common devotion. They had a common generosity, and they had a common passion, a common devotion. They were devoted to the apostles' teaching, which for us is the word of God. They were devoted to it. It wasn't something that they just maybe listened to once in a while, but they were devoted to the word. They were devoted to each other. They were devoted to the fellowship, which is, by the way, where we get our Christ fellowship name, right from this passage of scripture, if you ever wondered. They were devoted to, there was a commitment they had to one another. They loved each other with all their faults and failures and warts and everything. They still loved each other. And they were devoted to prayer, and they were devoted to gathering together for worship. That was a devotion that they made. There was a common devotion. Then they had a common generosity. They shared what they had. They gave freely. Somebody needed something. Okay, well, we're going to find out a way to meet that need. We're going to help them out. We're going to give, right? I think they recognized that the one that they were worshiping gave his all, gave everything. So anything that they might be called on to give was nothing compared to what Jesus gave his life, right? So there was a spirit of generosity that was life-giving in these people. And then they had a common passion. It was all about Jesus, man. They gathered, it says, every day in homes and in the temple courts and in the streets to worship Jesus. It was obvious what they were passionate about. I mean, it was obvious that they loved Jesus. They weren't trying to hide it or cover, man, they were bold in it. And this is important. As a result of the way they lived their life, we are here today. As a result of the way the early church lived out their faith, and they served one another, and they loved one another, and they're devoted to the word and to each other and to worship, because of that, we are here today. I want you to see, this is not some random story that took place 2,000 years ago that has nothing to do with us today in 2017. No, no, no. It has everything to do with us today. These people are actually your great, 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 great spiritual grandparents, aren't they? The way they were gave and the way they lived out their faith, the way they told everybody about Jesus, because of that, we are here today. See, Jesus didn't give the Great Commission to just a few followers. He gave it to his church, all of us. So if you are in Christ, guess what? That is your Great Commission. Go, therefore, into all the world and preach and teach the gospel of Jesus Christ, baptizing him, making them my disciples. That's for all of us to live. That's your mission, by the way. And as these people lived out their faith, I want you to notice the world was turned upside down. Was never the same after this day and the way they lived that out. Jerusalem in one day was turned upside down because 120 people gathered in an upper room to wait on the Holy Spirit, but they didn't stay in the upper room holding hands and singing kumbaya. No, they got out of there and they went out into the streets, out into their community to proclaim who Jesus really was, because if they had stayed there, they would have never gone where they needed to go. The same is true for you and me. If we stay where we are, we'll never go where God needs us to go. So if 120 of them could literally not just turn Jerusalem upside down, not just turn Israel upside down, not just turn the Roman Empire upside down, not just turn the world upside down for thousands of years, 120 of them, imagine what we could do together as the Church of Jesus Christ today. And how it makes me ask the question, how should South Florida look different because of our faith? How should South Florida be different because Christ Fellowship is here? Now listen, we know there are a lot of great churches in South Florida, and we partner with all of them. We're gonna talk a little bit about that in the coming weeks. Man, we link arms, we realize we ain't the only one. We're just a part of the body of Christ here. But we have, the Bible says to whom much is given, much is required. And we feel a sense of spiritual responsibility over this region where God has planted us to lead this region, to help link arms and bring together in unity the body so that people will be turned back to God. So what should it look like? What should our nation look like? I mean, I'm believing it should be different. See, I believe with all my heart that The church is the hope for the world. I believe with all my heart. You cannot convince me otherwise, because Jesus is the hope for the world. Amen? You agree with that? Okay, it's not government. We know that for sure. It's not Hollywood. We know that for the hope for the world is Jesus, and the church is the body of Christ here on the earth today. And my favorite, one of my favorite verses in the New Testament that captures this, and if you've been around here more than a week, you probably heard me exhorting on this verse, is Ephesians chapter 1, verse 23 out of the Message. It says this: the church you see is not peripheral to the world. The world is actually peripheral to the church. Peripheral just means tangential. It's off to the side. It's not the main focus. And so he's saying the world is not the focus. Actually, the church is the focus. The church, and here's why, because the church is Christ's body, in which he speaks, and in which he acts, and he fills everything with his presence. See, I want you to see something today. The focus of Jesus' attention is on the church. He sees the world, but his focus isn't on the world. His focus is on the church. Because his hope is in the church, that he could move and fill everything and every place with his presence and his glory through the church. The way Jesus wants to fill the office where you work is through his church. The school where you go to, he wants to do it through his church. The grocery store where you shop, the coffee shop where you get coffee, the way he wants his presence and his spirit to permeate those places is through the church, through us. So Jesus is putting all his eggs in that basket right there. So I want you to know what we are doing together, what we are building together, what we are giving ourselves together. The Bible says it's not peripheral. It's not secondary. It is central to everything that God wants to do through his church in the earth today. David said in Psalm 26, I love the house where you live, O God, the place where your glory dwells. I love your house, God. And I want you to know, man, I love the church. I love the church. I've grown up in the church. I found my purpose and my destiny and my friends and my wife all in the church. I found so much in God's church. I found my purpose. I know the church isn't perfect because we're all here. You know what I'm saying? It can't be perfect because you here, I'm here. Can't be. I tell people all the time, if you find things in our church that aren't perfect, like you're like, I can't believe they don't do that. I can't believe they do things that way. That shouldn't upset you. No. It should actually make you happy. They're not perfect. Because if we were perfect, there'd be no place for you here. You know what I'm saying? Right? And I've told you this before. If you find the perfect church, don't join it because you will screw it up. And so would I. Because we're a bunch of imperfect people that loving a perfect God as best we know how and loving each other as best we know how and just one day at a time, man. And by the way, Jesus surrounded himself with imperfect people. If you read through the Gospels, you see he had, you know, his disciples, they were all arguing and trying to be first and sit at his right hand and doing, and Peter, he was just cutting off ears and spouting off at the mouth. I mean, he was just crazy. Judas was backstabbing, right? He hung out with prostitutes and sinners and tax collectors. But listen, that didn't change who Jesus was and who Jesus is. Jesus surrounded himself with people who weren't perfect, but it didn't change him. So don't confuse the imperfect people in the church with the perfect God-ordained purpose that is on the church, all right? Don't get those two messed up and go, I'm just not gonna go to church. No, hey, the church is in the center of God's perfect plan to reach the world for Jesus Christ. It is plan A and there is no plan B. I've heard people say before, well, I love Jesus, I just don't really like the church. Or I'm into Jesus, I'm just not into the church. And when I hear that, I'm just utterly confused. How in the world can you even make that statement? What that tells me is they don't read their Bible. Because if they actually read their Bible and knew what Jesus was all about, Jesus is all about the church. Jesus gave his life for the church. Jesus came to this earth to establish the church. He's all up in the church. It's his bride, the Bible says. In Ephesians chapter 5, it tells us he died. Christ loved the church and gave his life up for her. Newsflash, the church is worth dying for. So if Jesus would die for the church, what should our commitment look like to the church?
Come on, just think about it for a minute. If Jesus would lay down his life, if he would leave the glory and splendor of heaven and come to earth, establish, because he said, I will build my church. That's what he's doing today. He's building his church. So if that's his heart, if that's where his attention is, what should my commitment to the church look like? What should my heart be for the house of God? You've been hearing us see these signs all around about my heart for God's house, the house of God. I want our hearts to get more in love with everything God's trying to do through the church. First time the term house of God is used is back in the book of Genesis at the very beginning. Genesis 28 is the first place house of God is used. Jacob is the grandson of Abraham, and he's on his way to find a bride, and he's traveling, and he finds a place to set up camp. He falls asleep and he has this amazing dream and a vision of heaven, and there's this stairway going up to heaven. I guess that's where Led Zeppelin got his idea for a song right there. And so Jacob goes up the stairway and he encounters the Lord, and the Lord blesses him and gives him promise. And when he wakes up, this is what he says in verse 16. Then Jacob awoke from his sleep and said, surely the Lord is in this place and I wasn't even aware of it. What an awesome place this is. It is none other than the house of God, the very gateway to heaven. Notice a couple things in this verse. He says, surely the Lord is in this place. I can tell you with all confidence, because God's word declares it, that when we gather together in this place on the weekends, when we come together to sing and to pray and to look to the word of God, God himself is here with us. God Almighty is in his house to meet with us. Jesus said in Matthew 18, verse 20, I want you to say it with me. For where two or three gather in my name, there I am with them. Where two or three gather, why would you want to miss Jesus? He's here to help us and speak into us and give us what we need. And I said, well, Jesus is everywhere. Isn't he omnipresent? Yeah, he's omnipresent. But there is a difference between the omnipresence and the manifest presence. He's all over the place. He's at, you know, Dairy Queen and down at Shoney or whatever. He's all over the place, but it's different when his children gather together and say, God, we welcome you here. Would you speak into our lives? Holy Spirit, would you reveal yourself, reveal your truth to us? He's gonna show up and do some things that only he can do when we put ourselves in that place to receive it in Jesus' name. I wonder, look at that verse. What an awesome place, verse 17, what an awesome place this is. It is none other than the house of God. Say that last phrase with me. The very gateway to heaven. The very gateway, the house of God, the very gateway. I wonder how many of you could say it was in the house of God where I really got to know God, where I really began to understand who he was, and I began to understand who Jesus is and what he wants to do in my life. In fact, if it was in a church where you had a revelation of Jesus, or you came back, maybe Christ Fellowship, maybe another church, but you begin to understand everything that God has for you and how you grow in that relationship with him. If it was in a church where you experienced it, would you just raise your hand up and hold them up high at all our campuses? If it was in it, yeah, look around. Just look around at all your campuses. Look at all the people who had an experience with God in the very house of God. You can put your hands down. Lives changed. Lives impacted for eternity. You know, personally, for me, it was in church. I was second grade, and I was in a children's ministry area, and there was a children's ministry volunteer that was telling us the story of Jesus and about salvation, and that was the day that I knew I had to turn my life over to Jesus Christ. I remember the room. I remember the seven or eight kids that were in the room when she was telling us about it. So you never know when you're a children's worker volunteer the impact you're going to have for the kingdom of God. Thank you, children's worker volunteers. And thank you, Mom and Dad, for getting me in church, not when I felt like it or didn't want. I had to go all the time. We were there all the time. They weren't even pastors, and I had to go all the time. But thank you for making it a priority, because parents, you need people that are going to echo your voice. Because Mom and Dad have been telling me about Jesus, but it was that day when God said, this is the day for Todd. Right? You need people that are echoing the voice of God over your children's lives, because there are a lot of other voices they are hearing all the time saying, try this, do that, everything's okay, doesn't hurt, go for it. Man, they need godly men and women speaking the truth over them in Jesus' name. You got to get them here on the weekends, every weekend. You need to be like my parents, take some lessons from my parents and get them in church. When I was a teenager, I had a youth student pastor that would speak the word of God over me, would tell me the truth of who I am, that I didn't have to listen to the lies that were swirling from the enemy or what kids at school. I could walk in my destiny. I had a youth pastor that was echoing the voice of God and coaching me on how to live for God. And I want to tell you, you need that. You know, Psalm 92 is a scripture that we talk about some around here about being planted in the house of God. Look what it says. Those who are planted in the house of the Lord will flourish in the courts of our God. They will still bear fruit in old age. They will be fresh and flourishing. Doesn't that sound good? One version says they will be fat and flourishing. I'm going to stick with the fresh and flourishing, if that's okay with you. But I want you to flourish. I want everyone to flourish that gets planted in the house of God. Think about when you plant a tree, what do you want it to do? You want it to flourish. You want it to bear much fruit and stay healthy and strong and vibrant. That word planted means to be established and fixed, not potted, where I get up and move when I feel like, no, I am planted in the house of the Lord. And I was thinking about this scripture this week, and when you think about it, when a tree is flourishing and producing fruit, the fruit isn't for the tree. The orange tree doesn't eat oranges, right? The apple tree's not like, no, I mean, the apple tree, the fruit is for other people. So when God wants you planted and flourishing, your life is gonna produce spiritual food that is gonna be for other people to come and find and know God in a real way, because there are so many people in our region that still need Jesus. There's so many people at the place that you work and the schools that you go to and the neighborhoods that you live in that need the spiritual fruit of your life. So you come here, we equip you here so you can make an impact there. On the weekends, we're equipping you here so you can make the impact in your world. See, as you get to know God and you grow in your relationship with God and you discover your purposes and the gifts that God's put in you, then you're ready to go impact your world with the love and the message of Jesus Christ. And that's our mission together as a church. You know our mission statement? Once you put it up on our screens, I want everybody to say this with me out loud. Say it like you mean it. Right, here we go. We are called to impact our world with the love and the message of Jesus Christ. Everyone, every day, everywhere. And as we do that, every one of us, everyone who are in Christ, every day, not just on Saturdays or Sundays or one day we're choosing to be nice, but every day and everywhere we go, let me tell you, more and more and more people are gonna be drawn to the light of Jesus Christ that is shining bright through your life. I guarantee it. And I have people say to me, well, Todd, how many more people are you trying to get in your church? How many more campuses are you? Try, how many campuses do you have? Don't you think that's enough? No, it's not. See, we are not impressed with the number of campuses we have or the number of people that show up here on the weekend. The number that is impressed on our hearts is 1.4 million. That's the number of people in our region that are living today that do not know Jesus. And if they don't come to know Jesus, they're gonna spend an eternity without Jesus. That is the number that drives us. That is the number that makes us wanna give and sacrifice and serve so that one more can know about the hope and the love that Jesus came to give them, amen? And by the way, there was a report that came out last year that said from Palm Beach County, West Palm Beach, all the way up to Port St. Lucie is the most never churched people group in America. Never been churched. The largest number of people that have never been churched, never been into a church, is right here. Not in Las Vegas, not in San Francisco, not in New York. Help us, Jesus. We got a lot of work to do, people. I mean, I look at that report and I think, oh God, help us. Help us to live out this mission. Help us to enlarge the place of our tent. Help us to stretch wide. Help us to pray some bigger prayers. Help us to believe that you're gonna actually use us above and beyond anything that we could think or imagine. Now we're in a great season, by the way. For our church, Julie and I were praying about this season we're walking into, God has dropped some words specifically in our heart that this is going to be the greatest season that we have ever experienced as a church. So I'm like, what does that look like? I don't know. It's gonna be great. But we've been praying over that. The other words that have come in our heart for the last about a year has been exponential increase. And again, we don't know what that completely looks like, but we are like, okay, God, we got to get ready for that increase you're gonna bring us. We gotta enlarge and make room for what you wanna do in us and through us. And we should have had a clue. When we launched Port St. Lucie campus last year in the middle of summer, and we were expecting about 700 people to show up because we had 300 people that were helping us launch the campus that were going to Stuart. And so we thought, okay, we might double, you know, maybe triple, go to 900, woo! And so we had a sanctuary out of one of the, where all the cubicles were. It's not even a real sanctuary, it's a hallway with, we cleared out. And we had over 3,000 people show up on opening weekend, expecting 700 to 900. And now we've got 2,500 people up there every week. This is one sanctuary. There's another room right across the way that looks like that one. Look, they're full. We got people sitting in the hallway up in Port St. Lucie. Look at them, they're sitting on the hallway, finding Jesus. So many people far from God that are finding a spiritual home. All of you that gave to the 180 Challenge, thank you. There are so many people doing a 180 up there and their lives are being forever changed because of Jesus Christ. I wanna thank, there's the Sage family. They walked in the doors and the kids heard about baptism and they're like, oh, we wanna be baptized, mom and dad. And so that led them through a whole process of learning about Jesus, turning their hearts over to Jesus. The whole family got baptized together. I wish I had time to tell you about Jace, this teenager that found faith and turned his life over to Christ in our middle. So I don't have time to tell you. There's so many life change stories going on up in Port St. Lucie, and there's so many more families that need to come to Christ. There's more Jaces that need to find their way in, and we gotta make room so they're not sitting in a hallway. So we're actually getting ready to build, we are getting ready to build a sanctuary up in Port St. Lucie. I think they have a picture of that's the current building and where that red blob is right there. Don't you love our high-tech drawings here? We're putting our money in the important places. So there, and that's the inside of the sanctuary. That's gonna be an 1,800 seat. I love it that it's filled, every chair is filled up. Well, there's one empty chair, maybe two. And that's the outside facing I-95. We're gonna make a place that is a spiritual home for people to find Jesus up in Port St. Lucie, amen? And then Stuart campus. Man, Stuart, a huge reason Port St. Lucie is doing so great is because you became a parent last year and you birthed a campus and you sent 300 leaders, spiritual pioneers up the road. And since we've launched Port St. Lucie, Stuart campus has grown with all new people and you've backfilled all those people that left. You've backfilled it and now we got a problem up in Stuart campus again. We have a parking problem. I think they got a picture of the parking lot. They're parking on the grass. They're parking on the roads. They're in the next picture. They're parking everywhere. Look at that. They're everywhere. There's no parking anywhere, which is a great problem for a church to have. There's a lot of churches that wish they had that problem. So we're going to do something about that problem. We're going to enlarge the place of our parking, okay? It's not really the tent, but the place of our parking. And so that's the space, that whole red, those red blobs again, are the place where we're gonna put some new parking spaces up there. We're gonna make room so it's easy for people to come in and connect with God on the weekends in Jesus' name, amen? And then Boynton Beach, Boynton, all the way at the other end of our territory and our region is down in Boynton. Pastor Sean and Teresa have been down there loving on the people as we've been looking for our new campus pastor to lead that campus down there. But man, as Sean and Teresa have been there and the team working so well, we have gone over 4,000 people and we are out of space. The sanctuaries are packed. The overflows are packed. The rooms are packed. We've added services as well up there. So we're just out of room. The journey room, I think they got a picture of the journey room. It is slammed full of people. There's one classroom in the entire space and they flip it and use it all the time. There's hardly spaces for breakouts for our students anywhere. Everything's full down there. That's the bad news or the good news. That's good, right? And the other good news is that we have a whole second floor that we get to develop, right? We're not out of space, the whole second floor of Dillard's. And I believe they have a plan there of what we're gonna do. We're gonna create some spaces for groups to be able to gather, for journey, for people to take their next steps in faith in Jesus Christ, for our young adults and our ministries to expand there. So that's happening. And again, there are so many great things at all of our campuses. I wish I could tell you about Okeechobee and this lady named Dakota that just kept getting loved on by the people that were going to church. And she said, well, I think she was waitressing somewhere. And she said, I'm gonna go to this church and try it out. She goes to the journey class, she gets saved. She starts dragging her family into church and her daughter Tori is pregnant, but it's got some complications. There's a tumor on the baby. And so they bring Tori up and pray for her, lay hands on her. And the Bible says that Jesus is still healing today. And guess what? Tori went back to the doctor. There's no tumor on that baby whatsoever. She's healed, she's whole. The whole family's coming to church now. You know, I guess they would. Christ Fellowship in Espanol is growing and expanding. We're out of room for the kids' areas. We've got to do something about that. City Place, we have been just launched our city nights down at City Place, 7 p.m. every Sunday night down there, having a night of worship and life teaching. And it's been great. And we've got people that came down for a latte and they're finding the Lord. They're walking up the steps and they're finding Jesus down there. I love it. Royal Palm Campus, we finally did some work on the future development area. 12 years ago, when we converted the Target store into a house of worship, we had this future development area that we'd work on sometime in the future. Well, we got started on that, but we got a lot more work to do. That space needs a lot of help in that area. For every time we have Christmas and Easter or big services, it overflows into that space. We want to upgrade all of our children's spaces and our student spaces. We want that place to be the most engaging place. Our kids, they're running in there on the weekends. They're waking their parents up, even on the weekends where we lose an hour of sleep, and they're saying, "Come on, Mom and Dad, we got to go to church." Amen? So we're going to make it great out there in Royal Palm in Jesus' name. Gardens Campus, we got some work to do here in our student areas and making space for all of our life groups, for our students and our kids, a better overflow for our sanctuary. And if you were with us a couple weeks ago, we announced our most recent newest campus. We're going to be going to the town of Jupiter this fall with a new Christ Fellowship campus out there. And here's what we know. Every time where we put a stake in the ground and brought the light of Jesus to that area, we have seen people change, families change, children change. And so we had our first little meeting and had over 300 people show up as a launch team. This is a launch team for a campus. That could be a church some places. And they're getting ready to go launch. We're going to be launching up there at the Jupiter High School, right in the heart of Jupiter. It's got about 800, 900 seats in the auditorium. And we're going to be launching there on August 20th. So let me ask you to be praying about that, because I want you to know we don't flippantly just say, "Yeah, we're launching a campus. Woo." No, we understand the spiritual responsibility that comes with that. We understand that every time we go to take new territory, the enemy's not happy and there's going to be battles in that. And so we've got to stand in prayer for God to do what only He can do. We're working with churches up in Jupiter again, linking arms with them so that we can see Jupiter for Jesus in 2017. Amen? And I want you to begin praying with us about two things. I want you to be praying with us about Riviera Beach and West Palm Beach. Riviera Beach and West Palm Beach. Julie and I have had a burden that has increased over this last couple of years for Riviera Beach and West Palm Beach. Hundreds of thousands of people right here in our region, right in the heart of our region, that need our love. And so we're praying and dreaming about ministry centers, like maybe things we have out in Belglade. How would that fit here in our region? Campuses. I believe we're going to have a campus or two right there in the heart of West Palm Beach. And so I need you praying about that with me on that. Are they playing music already? Which is the signal to say wrap it up. But man, there's so much in my heart for our church moving forward. In the next 4 years, we're gonna plant four more campuses in this region. Four campuses in 4 years. We're going north, south, east, and west in Jesus' name. We're gonna go east. We can even get east from where we are already. We're gonna go east. Boca needs Jesus. Fort Pierce Vero, they need Jesus. The Western communities need Jesus. And we're gonna do whatever it takes to reach this region for Jesus Christ. We're gonna make it hard for people to go to hell in South Florida. Every place they bump in is somebody, right? They're driving along and they're seeing the cross equals heart stickers everywhere. And they're like, what is going on? People talking about Jesus all the time. Amen. So we are entering this season that I am calling a heart for the house. It is a time where I'm praying that God would give each of us, even me, a greater love for His house and everything that He wants to do in and through His church, which is us in this place. And we say all the time that the church isn't a building, it's a family, but families need places together and have meals and talk and care for one another. And so we've got to create some more rooms in our home where that's going to happen. When you came in today, you got a booklet, and this booklet really outlines much of what I share today, and some things maybe I didn't get to share today, but I want you to take this and pray over this. I want you to begin to pray about how you are a part of this mission together, because everything we clapped and cheered about, woo, Jupiter, woo, West Palm, yeah, all that takes money and time and treasure and talent. All of that takes, every time the church of Jesus Christ through the ages has moved forward, it's been people saying, "Yeah, we're gonna sacrifice to move the church forward." And so we're gonna, in May, coming up in a couple months, we're gonna have what I'm calling a Heart for the House offering. And that offering is different than a building campaign because it's not like a 3-year pledge we're making. That offering is different than our Christ birthday offering, which all of that is used for missions and outreach. This is to make the house of God vibrant and strong and ready and enlarge and increase so that we can meet the needs of the people in our community in Jesus' name. We have a mission. It's clear. God's given us a clear vision for our church and for our region, but our response will actually set the pace of the vision. Your giving, my giving, will actually set the pace for how quickly we can accomplish this mission and vision that God has given to us. So when you leave today, you're gonna get two things. You're gonna get a little commitment card for you to pray over. You're not gonna give that today, but I want you to pray about it. And at Christ Fellowship, we've never pressured anybody to do anything but obey Jesus. And when you obey Jesus and I obey Jesus and mom and dad obey Jesus and we give whatever God tells us to give, we're able to do everything that God is asking us to do in the timing that he wants us to. So take that card and pray about it over these next few weeks and just say, God, what is it that you want us to sacrifice? As a family, what is it that you want us to give? And then you're gonna get one of these little white bracelets when you leave today. And I don't normally like to wear these things. You know, people give them out for all sorts of things. And it says on here, my heart for God's house. And I just want you to wear this over the next few weeks and months as we're in this heart for the house season. So it can remind you that we are the church, everyone, every day, everywhere, and that God is calling us to make a difference in this world and in this region. Would you stand with me at all of our different locations? I wanna pray for us. Church, I wanna tell you, Julie and I love you so much, and we love what we get to do together for Jesus, that we get to lift his name up and make him famous over this region. And as we do that, it will impact the world, I believe with all my heart. So I wanna pray for you. I wanna pray that you would flourish. I wanna pray that you would enlarge and expand as well. Father God, thank you for the men and women that we call family, for the students and children that fill this house with their laughter and their joy, that they love you and that they love coming to church and growing in you. And God, I pray that you would help us as a church to accomplish everything that you've set before us in this next season. We actually believe it's gonna be the greatest season that we've ever experienced. And God, I pray that over these coming days, we would respond and move forward and have an enlarged heart for the house of God. I speak blessing over every family represented here, over every individual, that God, you would cause them to flourish and to increase so that your name can be made known. It's in Jesus' name that we pray. And everybody said, amen, amen. Hey church, listen, if you need prayer for anything, we're here to pray with you. We love you so much. Go with God.